I don't want to be just the person in Computerphile who does all the history and nothing but history. I'd actually like to do some programming with you. And some of you in the comments have actually said, why don't you do Java or teach us some C or something? And I thought, no, I've got a very good opportunity here to lead off from the PostScript story that I've been telling and actually do some PostScript programming with you. It's pretty easy to get software, both for Linux, for Mac and for PC, that will enable you to run the programs that I develop with you and even create ones of your own. And I think that's important. It's no use me getting into some language where the support is utterly minimal. PostScript was invented at Adobe by John Warnock and a team of co-helpers. It built on work that he'd done several years earlier when he worked with the Evans and Sutherland graphics company. I think he'd done some more work on it in a language called Jam when he was at Xerox PARC. The M in Jam standing for John and Martin, that's right. M is for Martin Newell. Anyway, it became fully fledged when it got to Adobe. It's a very big language. It's got something like 400 operators in all. But I think I've already said, and let me emphasize again, it's far more than a two-dimensional graphics language. It is a full-blown programming language. It can do anything that any other language can do. It can do anything that a Turing machine can do. And for that reason, it's called a Turing-complete language. We're going to print out six instances of the text Computerphile. First of all, I'm going to do it with, if you like, a proper conventional PostScript program, and no surprises in guessing that it will involve a for loop that goes around six times. It's vital that you know something about PostScript and how it works. First of all, it's an interpreted language. Many of you will know what that means. It means it's things like Perl, Python, JavaScript. For the older generation among you, it's things like Lisp. What it means, if you have an interpreted language, is you look at what has been requested in the program and you do it there and then. That way you gain great flexibility. It doesn't necessarily run all that fast. That's the real challenge. It's in the very nature of PostScript that it uses a notation called postfix, and that in turn relies for its execution environment on this notion of a stack. We may be in a position to put this out as a separate film in its own right. This is Postfix. I think his name is pronounced something like Jan Łukasiewicz. People being unable to pronounce his name correctly and getting all the stresses and accents wrong decided that rather than pronouncing what they found hard, they would call this Polish notation. Now, actually, Polish notation applies to using anything that isn't infix. I've seen prefix notation being called forward Polish notation. I've seen postfix given its traditional name of reverse Polish notation. The stack is last in, first out storage. The last thing I put on the stack, I pushed it on, was this little white one. The only thing I can directly get at the top of the stack is this same thing. So it's the last thing in, but it's the first thing off. And the act of taking it off the stack is called popping the stack. So we'll keep this to one side, just to remind us that PostScript is totally, totally stack-based in every single thing it does. And I'm now in a position that I can actually go through the for loop version of the program with you. I'll be talking about stacks until you're fed up of hearing about them. First of all, anything beginning percent in PostScript is a comment. There's a very special comment right at the top of your PostScript program, which effectively invites you to announce which version of Adobe PostScript this program will be compliant with. What I've said here is this requires PostScript, defined by Adobe, version 2.0. Most of the time, in most PostScript interpreters nowadays, you don't really have to bother about that. The minimum you can get away with is just the percent and the exclamation mark. Opinions differ as to whether exclamation mark ought to be called shriek or bang. It's all from comic books, you know, shriek, exclamation mark, or bang, lots of exclamation marks. I tend to call it bang. So when I say percent bang, it means it's the top of a PostScript program. PostScript allows you to have things like characters, real numbers, integer numbers, things of that sort that you would expect. It's not what is called a strongly typed language. You don't have to tell PostScript here that 6 is an integer. It knows. And it's fairly cavalier about what it will let you do with those. But then it says, if you ask me to define 6 as being n, which is what this is doing, then fine, I'll regard it as being an integer version of 6. If you mean no 6 that I can print out on a printer, so it's the ASCII character 6, then I will give you conversion operators that will convert it into printable strings. So it finds out from context what it thinks is plausible for the type of these things. So here we go, look, our first example use of reverse Polish PostScript notation. Forward slash n means I want to define a variable called n. Here it is on the stack. There's the 6. Def is a PostScript operator which does definitions. In other words, it binds a value to a variable name. So what this is saying is, make my integer variable n represent the value 6. And it does that by taking them off, storing away n with the value 6 inside it, somewhere inside PostScript memory. Now here's another wonderful example of PostScript postfix use. First operand this time, the font name, OCRA. So what I'm saying to PostScript here is, you know where the fonts are kept that I'm using. Find one called OCRA and push on the stack the name, the font name, OCRA. When you found OCRA, push on here the required point size of it and the operator. This is called select font. So it binds this point size to this font and says, right, that's what we're using. I think I said way, way back and early on that we might encounter conventional programming constructs in PostScript, and we do. This is a for loop. But notice it's in postfix. The operand, which is the for, comes last. Next to last in the curly braces is a bunch of program that we wish to execute every time we go around this for loop. The weird thing, oh, it's maybe not all that weird actually, is that the start value, the increment value and the final value are specified up at the top here. So when you come to think about it, if you're only to promote the for up to the top here, it would look a bit like Java or C. But writing it out this way, okay, you push the start value, you push the increment value and n, the terminating value, but n has been defined as 6. So it's saying basically, starting at 1, in steps of 1, up to 6, do the following piece of program. Every time it goes round, what you can rely on happening is that the current value of the loop counter will be available to you in the loop body every time round. So it will start off as 1, and I'll do the loop. Then I will increment the 1 to being a 2. Let's use this one for 2. Next time around the loop count will be 2. But here's the really handy thing. It'll be 2, but you can access that value of 2 at the top of the stack. Every time you look at the top of the stack, you can rely on having the current value of the loop counter there. What the loop is going to execute is 10, 100, move to. There's the operator. Here are the operands. So this one is the X position. And the default units are typographic points. And you all know about that, 72 points to the inch. This one is the Y position. So all that's happening here, your coordinate system starts down here at 0, 0. It starts at the lower left-hand corner and everything is relative to here. If I say move 10 in the X direction to there and move 100 in the Y direction to here, that's about an inch and a bit. A 10 is about a seventh of an inch. So round about there, I will print my first computer file. to be fair, you sometimes find that your 00 gets a little bit misaligned with the bottom of the physical paper, particularly if you insist on printing onto A4 size paper as if it was US letter size paper. But I hope you get the idea. Here's 00. We're going to move a little bit in on the x-axis, look, a seventh of an inch, about an inch up between every instance of this banner as we go up. And every time we do that move to, we then go on to the next line and it just says show the string Computerphile. Now, the way you do strings in PostScript is not with double quotes like you would in Java or C. You put them in round brackets, parentheses. So the only thing now to say, well, all right, it goes around six times, so you get six versions of Computerphile coming out. What on earth is all this and why are you doing that? First of all, I say 100 mul. Mul is going to say to itself that I'm the multiplier and I want two things to multiply together. But do remember, I warned you, or I told you, that at the top of the stack, every time around the loop, is the current loop counter value. So the first time around, this is 1. So basically, I'm saying 100 mul. And you'll say, that's not enough operands. You need two operands for a mole. No, I don't, because one of them's implicitly there already. At the top of the stack is a 1. So I'm pushing a 100 on top of it. Take this big one. That represents something big like 100. I put it on top, but there's the 1 already there. Then I say multiply. So the answer is 100 times 1 is 100. And I push that back on the top of the stack. Now, the first time around, of course, 1 times 100 is trivial, it's 100. But the next time around, it's going to be 2 times 100, which will make 200. Then 3 times 100, and so on. Once I've got the correct Y position calculated, I'm going to use this black one to represent the 10. And remember, the 10 points is the X offset every time. OK. So, I've got now 100... I've got 10. The only trouble is, unfortunately, you don't want 110 move to. You want 10 100 move to. In other words, if I'd written 10 100 move to, you stack the 10, you stack the 100, you do the move to. The bigger 100 is on top, not underneath. Why did it end up underneath? Well, it ended up there because I wanted to do some calculation and I left it behind as the answer. But PostScript has the answer. If your operands on the stack are the wrong way around, you do the exchange, the EXCH operator. I've got 110. I need them the other way around. So I exchange them. There we are. So I've changed what would have been 110 move to into 10 100 move to. And don't forget, as you read left to right in all of these things, the 10 and the 100, the 10 gets pushed on first, the 100 gets pushed on afterwards, and that's exactly the order in which move to expects to find them. It lifts them off and it says the Y value will be on top, the X value will be underneath. That's the use of exchange then, to flip things around at the top of the stack. And from then on, you know, everything is utterly straightforward. Okay, so we've analysed this PostScript program now with a simple for loop. You're familiar with moving to a new position on the page, with the fact that the show operator shows the immediately preceding string of characters, and that there's another operator called select font, which can be used to decide which font you're using and what point size you want it at. So there we are, that's the original for loop version of it, which has all the right effects. The interpreter I'm using, the PostScript clone interpreter, is one of the most famous ones. It's called GoScript. It was originally written in the early 90s by a guy called Peter Deutsch. It's freely out there. One of the many things that's been added to it over the years is a slightly more powerful viewing front end, as it were, called GhostView. But GhostView still relies on GoScript underneath. So what I'm going to do now is to run GhostView on the for loop version of the program. GV multi star opera.ps. There. Okay, so that's the for loop, and that produces six computer files running up the page.
We'd like to thank audible.com for supporting this Computerphile video. And if you'd like to check out one of their huge range of books, go to audible.com/computerphile and you can try one for free. Today I'd like to recommend Douglas Adams' book. Douglas Adams did The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which I love, and then rescued from his computer after his sad death was a book called The Salmon of Doubt. So check that out if you get the chance. So that's audible.com/computerphile. You can try one for free. Thanks them for supporting this video.